Slimes as living, bouncing blobs of goo are a very popular trope in many fantasy stories and games. In an earlier video, I already discussed how a slime creature might work biologically in terms of its anatomy and physiology. Now we're gonna take it to the next level and speculate on whether a creature like this could actually have evolved on our very own Earth. What lineage on our planet could be the best candidate for departing on such a journey? What evolutionary forces might drive a cascade of bodily innovations as to finally arrive at such an alien life form? And to what levels of complexity might we be able to take this weird but wonderful conceptual being? Let's find out. One reason slimes are so popular in our collective imagination may have to do with how completely different they are from the life forms that we're used to. So, to evolve a slime creature, we may need to find a radically different starting point. In part 1, we already discounted slime molds for lacking tissues and a coherent body. For true tissues, we have to start at the base of the animalian branch of life. And already one candidate came forward that fits the most basic requirements of a discrete and complex multicellular organism with a definite shape. Long believed to be closely related to cnidarians like jellyfish and corals, modern insights have shown that comb jellies or ctenophores are actually quite alien. They are relatively complex beings that appear to have found their own way. There are indications that they independently evolved their own neurons and muscle cells. They also have a through gut with a mouth at the bottom and a transient anus at the top. These so-called anal pores are only temporarily there, whenever needed, and disappear again after discharge of indigestible materials. Another unique feature is their biradial symmetry, which means that their two sides are arranged radially rather than laterally, as in bilaterians. They are in fact so different that they can be regarded as alternate animals. So let's recap the full requirements an evolving slime creature would have to meet. First of all, it would need a hydrostatic skeleton achieved by a body cavity or coelom that is held under pressure by a meshwork of muscle fibers. Then it would need to evolve a system of skeletal rods and central muscle bands for achieving jumping over land. In conjunction with that, it would also need eyes and a nervous system to know where to go. Further following our design, it would have to have a ciliated mucous epithelium on the outside for picking up and moving food particles to the mouth. Last but not least, a circulation and respiration system in order to grow to greater sizes. As it turns out, our ctenophorean ancestor would already have many of the above traits ready. Its body is like a bag of gelatinous matter surrounded by a single tissue layer. It has a network of muscle fibers that are arranged in concentric as well as radial ways and together create hydrostatic firmness. Its outer surface is decorated by 8 comb rows of beating hairs or cilia used for swimming. Specialized cells called coloblasts produce a sticky substance for catching small prey. It has a nervous network and a patch of photosensitive cells at a so-called apical organ. The latter could lay the foundation for a very simple visual system. So apart from being suspended in water rather than bouncing about on land, they're pretty much there already. On closer thought, how would we get from these innocuous and helpless blobs that always strand on our shores to the slime creature as specified? More specifically, why, as in what environmental forces would drive a relatively simple and defenseless creature onto this haphazard and perilous evolutionary journey? How would they survive and eventually thrive? For starters, one way to survive being stranded is by becoming amphibious. As an exception, starting in the open water column, some species may attain the ability to escape dangerous predicaments by sudden bursts of movement through quick contractions. The same technique could then in theory be used to bounce back to the azure again. Still, as we've seen in Earth's history, even the remotest islands are quickly colonized by airborne creatures like insects, birds, bats, and pterosaurs back in the day. So the transition of our proto-slimes to land would have to take place early enough to be well before other animal lineages had ventured onto land. The great Ordovician biodiversification event certainly made the oceans more thriving with active animal life, but also red in tooth and claw with many more ways to get eaten. Taking to the land would thus help these soft-bodied creatures to avoid the large water predators with hard parts that had been around since the Cambrian. The earliest tenophores were actually much more advanced than modern forms and did show clear signs of partaking in the evolutionary arms race of the early Cambrian. Not only did they have a centralized nervous system with a ring nerve around the mouth region and meridional nerve strands, they even had a skeleton. The sclerotinophora had skeletal elements arranged as spokes in an octoradial way, converging at the apical organ at the top, which was encased in 8 individual plates. This is an almost exact match of the original design for our slime's skeletal system. These early forms also were ornamented with spikes and other ways to increase their circumference in an apparent attempt to avoid getting eaten. A set of circumoral flaps probably boosted their swimming abilities. Departing from these forms, we can imagine one particular lineage may have increased its muscle mass for more powerful movements, perhaps even darting out of the water or briefly onto dry land. Stronger muscles would also mean an increase in dry weight. And modern tenophores are actually specialized in keeping the latter down by making most of their body volume consist of water, namely 85%. This way, they have to use less energy for staying buoyant. Vertebrates like bony fish solve this by having a swim bladder filled with air. Elasmobranchs like sharks often have very fatty livers instead. So, in connection with heavier muscles, we'd want to add internal air pockets as well. With other ancient tenophores going extinct, our lineage may persist into the Ordovician. By the time jawed fishes started to come to the fore during the Silurian period, our proto-slime ancestors would have found a safe haven on the shores or banks and beyond. At the same time, there would have opened up an entirely new world for them with plenty of food in the form of algae and primitive land plants. Now, atmospheric oxygen levels were relatively low until the late Ordovician. So once on land, our slime's air pockets would develop further into an intricate system of air sacs and canals. This would both add to a decrease of the weight to be moved about and also provide respiration by spreading oxygen to the deeper parts of the body. To prevent desiccation in dry air, our primitive slimes may adopt the same strategy as land snails by secreting tough slime on outer surfaces, further adding to its slimy nature. So just like how snails leave a slimy trail, so would our slimes leave slimy tracks. The ciliate structures could be spread all over the body and work to move the outer slime layer towards the mouth for recycling, while also consuming any food particles stuck to it. One unique tenophore feature that might come in handy here are the sticky colloblasts. So our proto-slimes may then simply sit on top of food sources and use a combination of colloblasts, cilia and slime to loosen up and transport edible matter for further digestion. Adapting to different niches on terrestrial environments may accelerate evolution. You could get both herbivorous grazing slimes and carnivorous hunting slimes. Some of our slimes may want to grow to greater sizes and move faster to either chase prey or escape predators. This will set increasing demands to the slime's nervous system and circulation system. Muscles around the air sacs may provide more active breathing, and this may also lead to muscular fluid canals moving nutrients and waste products around. This is especially important as slimes tend to settle on a more or less globular shape. Eventually, this could turn into a system of lungs and blood vessels. Directional movement would prompt the appearance of an antero-posterior body axis. The eyes would be set at the front of the slime animal, as well as the mouth, which moves from a position at the bottom upwards to the front aspect. To protect against radiation from the sun, an opaque skin layer may form with different kinds of pigmentation for camouflage or attracting mates. To avoid predation from later land creatures with tougher body parts, slimes may become poisonous, adopting bright coloration to reflect that and to serve as a warning. Another extra actinophore feature to be marshaled would be bioluminescence, or the ability to produce light using photosites. And there you have it, fully evolved, intelligent, brightly colored, slimy slime beings. I hope you enjoyed this little speculative evolution. If you did, please leave a like and a comment. And if you have some ideas for further or alternate evolutionary pathways, do let us know in the comment section below. Please also do subscribe and don't forget to hit the bell icon. In any case, thanks for watching, cheers and bye-bye.